All right, welcome. This is a great love of mine, is archaeology. You know, you might know that my dad was a scientist. I grew up with science, and archaeology is kind of a nice blend of religion and faith about what is the evidence that certain things have occurred. So I do go to the Middle East every year. We have our 12th trip going. This will be my 15th time going, but my 12th time with the tour. And every time we go, we examine what is the archaeological evidence that these biblical stories occurred. Tonight, I'm going to be talking about just the most recent ones. In the past, I've talked about Bethlehem archaeology, the Easter archaeology, the childhood of Jesus at Nazareth, his ministry at Capernaum. But tonight is just going to be the most recent and really, I think, some of the most interesting. So we're going to talk about these topics. We're going to talk about what just happened really just a few months ago at the Jesus tomb in Jerusalem. We're talking about the latest archaeology about King David, the Magdala Synagogue, what's called the Sifting Project in Jerusalem, the famous Shroud of Turin, and then St. Peter's Tomb. By the time that you leave here at 1 o'clock in the morning, you will have this down really cold. It's really a lot here. So let me just get right into it. I hope to go through these in detail, but also with some speed, and because I'm also very interested in your questions. And you're absolutely welcome to ask questions about any topic in archaeology, not just on the topics that are here, okay? I think they're gonna pass a microphone around so that we can all hear your questions. So let's first talk about the Jesus tomb. This is most of the tombs that were in what they call first century time, at the time of Jesus, looked something like this. This is not actually the picture of the tomb of Jesus, but they all looked very similar. It was basically a hole cut into a vertical cliff face and a small room that was cut inside. Inside that room, there would be ledges across all three walls, and sometimes almost like, just imagine a pizza oven. Sorry for the image. Just imagine a pizza oven with a hole and then, you know, going into the rock that you would put the pizza. Instead, you put Uncle Ernie in there instead. And that was actually called a kokim type of tomb. And kokim is actually Hebrew for oven. So it looks, because it looked like an oven. They would put the body in there, either in the hole or on the ledge, and close up the tomb again with the rolling stone that you see there. And then about a year later, they would come back to the tomb, roll back the stone, take out the bones of Uncle Ernie, and put them in a box called an ossuary, which comes from the Greek word for bones. And then either the ledge or the oven tomb would be available for the next family member. So this would be a family mausoleum, if you will. So there might be, you know, generations buried in there. You know, each person who died would get their year on the ledge or in the oven, and then placed in an ossuary box. So this is what the outside would look like. It really was a rolling stone that would open up and close the tomb. So this is an artist rendering of the inside. So you see, if you walk into the tomb, on your right would be the ledge. Most archaeologists believe that Jesus was in this kind of a tomb. This ledge is called an arcosolium. So he was in, rather than in the oven type, he was on the ledge type, an arcosolium. So this is an artist rendering of really what all tombs looked like at that time. So it's reasonable to expect this is the kind of place where Jesus was laid. Ironically, one of the most archaeologically verified sites in all of Israel is the place where Jesus was crucified and was buried. The reason is kind of ironic, and that is, let me just go to the next slide here. This is Jerusalem today, and that is, you see those two silver or grayish silver domes, they are over the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Holy Sepulchre, meaning holy grave of Jesus. The reason why this is one of the most archaeological verified sites, and I go into this a lot in detail in the other talk, but just real briefly here, there's about 10 different markers for it. Remember, it says that Jesus was buried in a garden tomb outside the city walls, by the city gate, you know, these kinds of things that are mentioned. Those are all kind, those are all circumstantial evidence. Really, one of the most remarkable deals is a quality of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire basically allowed you to live the life that you wanted unless you threatened Rome. And if you threatened Rome in any way, they retaliated. But not eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. If you just did a little bit of retaliation, they crushed you. Massive retaliation. Massive, because they wanted it to be an example to everybody else so that no one else would ever retaliate. And one of the ways they would do that is not only militarily by killing everybody, but also culturally. They would find out, what is your most precious thing? What is the thing that you most value and treasure? What is the religious place that you hold most sacred? And they would investigate to make sure they would know exactly where that was. And once they found it was right here, is this it right here? Is this your most sacred place? Really? Really? And crush it again. Smash it. And then they would build their temple on top. Thank you, Rome, right? Because that was a way of showing domination. They would say, would crush your thing and put their temple on top. So they did that to the Jewish temple. In 70 AD, they crushed the Jewish temple and put a Roman temple on top. And sometime later, they found out where the Christian sacred site was and put a Roman temple on top of the Christian site. Now think about that. The Romans put a Roman temple on top of the Christian site. So ironically, archaeological evidence of that Roman temple verifies this is the site. Thank you, Rome. Their effort, ironically, in destroying Christianity ended up verifying to Queen Helena and the rest afterwards that this was the site of Jesus' tomb. So Constantine and then the Crusaders later built a church over this site. Actually, the Calvary site and the tomb site, we often think of them as being in radically different areas because you have an image of Calvary and then later on you have an image of Easter. They were actually only about 30 yards apart. Where Jesus was crucified and where he was buried is about approximately 30 to 35 yards from each other. And so they were close enough that they could build a single church over both. So this is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Over the large dome is built over the tomb. The smaller dome is actually built over a Greek Orthodox chapel. And approximately right here is underneath this roof here is where the crucifixion site is. And when we go there, we have mass. We can either choose whether we have mass in the tomb or on the crucifixion site. And it's very moving to be in a very archaeologically verified site. So this is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre over the tomb. Now, underneath that dome is a smaller structure called the edicule, coming from a Latin word for building. And so underneath the dome is this smaller structure that is built directly over the tomb site. Now, since around the year 700, after the Muslim conquest of this area, the Muslim Sultan destroyed completely the tomb site, razed it to the ground. Basically, again, that whole idea of cultural domination, is this your sacred site? Thanks for letting me know. And then they destroy it, okay? The Romans simply built it over it, but the Muslims basically sliced it off at the floor And so for centuries, basically, the idea was that we know the spot where the tomb was, but the tomb itself is missing. But in the 1800s, early 1800s, this inner building was built over the tomb and various altars inside. Just recently, last year, in the fall, after a lot of negotiations, it was decided that these buildings are very unsafe. They're kind of crumbling. They need a lot of repair. And so the three major religions that operate the Church of the Holy Sepulchre got together to undergo a renovation of this large building, and also for the first time to examine the foundations of the building to see just really what is there from the time of 700 to the time when we understood that the Muslim Sultan destroyed the tomb. Let's take a look. So they excavated. Now this is what the inside of the tomb looks like normally. Actually, I shouldn't say normally. Normally there's another board here and it's set up for mass. It's set up for mass. So the items for mass have been taken away. And this is just simply a marble slab that was placed there by the Crusaders in Crusader period, maybe around 1100 AD. So this marble slab was going to be taken away. This is where you would come in to the tomb area. And here we have a worker who is now examining underneath the slab. And here's one of the Franciscan priests who is looking at what's underneath the slab. And so this is what's this is the latest discovery. This is as of November of last year. And it's going to be a National Geographic special coming up soon. So I've seen a few tapes on it. It looks pretty good. So I don't normally recommend everything the National Geographic does, but I think this is going to be okay. So basically the discovery is this. It was long thought that the Muslims razed, sliced, and removed the entire cave of the tomb. All right, so if you can imagine, a cave is like this. At the time that they built the Holy, at the time that Constantine built the church over the Holy Sepulchre, the emperor removed much of the external part of the cave so that you just had kind of an igloo, you know what I mean? Like an igloo shape with the interior authentic, just an igloo shape. And then the story was that the Muslims sliced it off at the floor and removed it. Now it turns out that the Muslims didn't do that. They simply collapsed the building onto itself. Does that make sense? Now what happens when you collapse a building on itself? The underground is now protected. Meaning the slab where Jesus was laid is protected and can be revealed. And so the latest, this is just, let's see, it's 10 of 8 now. This is how recent this news is. This is really just several weeks old. So this is very exciting because it shows that, and you know, there's going to be a lot more studies and everything like that, but it looks like we have the actual slab that our Lord was laid on. This since the year 700. This is really remarkable news. It's just coming to view now. The nice thing is that this whole construction took about a year, and I was there last June, and it was already heavily involved, and at no point did they ever stop pilgrims from going into the tomb. You could always go into the tomb no matter what. They understood the power of it. They understood the attraction. So even though all this construction was going on, it was never... and we went in and had our visit and all that. So really is quite remarkable that and now what they're going to do is it's now been resealed, and there's going to be, when you walk in there, there's going to be a hole in the upper plaque now, and you'll be able to put your hand down and touch the stone on which laid the body of our Lord. Quite remarkable. That's the latest archaeology. This is very exciting. This is really, the next story is very inside baseball. When I go to the Middle East every year, I always go 1 or 2 days early to check out ancient Israel sites. Because our group is a Christian group, they're mainly interested in where did Jesus happen, but I'm also very, very fascinated in ancient Israel sites. So I usually go a couple of days early to check out those, and there's some really, really interesting information about that. Now, obviously, one of the greatest figures of the Hebrew Scriptures is King David, right? I mean, this is a seminal figure. I mean, the stories kind of lead up to King David and kind of lead away from King David. He really is a very, very powerful persona in the entire Hebrew Scriptures. But there was always a question because there just wasn't much actual archaeological evidence that the guy even existed. And there began to develop an entire community of scholars who were actually denying David, right? Fake news. It was fake archaeology news. There is no such thing as King David. And of course, who was in the forefront of saying that there was no such thing as King David? Palestinians, right? If there's no King David, there's no claim to this land, it's all bogus. The whole Israeli shtick is fake news. So what is the status of King David in science? We obviously know what he is in the Bible. What is it in science? Well, about 20 years ago, in an archaeological dig in the north of Israel, an archaeological assistant to a very famous archaeologist found a rock inscription that said, that included the phrase, in the special way that inscriptions indicate a house, a family tree, it said the words, House of David. That was the very first archaeological evidence that the House of David, not just a guy named Dave, but the House of David existed, right? So that was huge, but it was just like this one inscription. So this entire edifice of ancient Israel archaeology was based on just this one inscription. Well, there's another way of finding out whether King David matched the description in the gospel, in the scriptures. In the scriptures, King David is presented as a king, as a mighty king, with an empire and an army who conquered. Other people were saying, no, David was a minor shepherd chieftain of no consequence, a little hillbilly, literally a hillbilly living in the hill country of Judea of no consequence. So is he a minor shepherd chieftain or a great mighty king? There is no argument that if everybody understands that if this person David existed, they know he existed within this certain time period, roughly 1000 BCE. Now, one of the ways that you can determine the quality of a king is the size of the buildings they make, all right? Because kings like buildings. They have what's called an edifice complex. Archaeologists are very funny people. Because obviously if you're a king, you like to have a big building and you put your name on it, right? I built this, and that shows that you are a big, big king. So in archaeology, it's simply called monumental structures. So what are the, now there's plenty of monumental structures dated to the time of Solomon, but nothing dated to the time of David. And so that was leading credence to both the Palestinians and other archaeologists saying that David was a minor shepherd king of no consequence, the Bible exaggerated, and the Bible can't be trusted. Does that make sense? Yeah. So two things happened recently, one in 2009, 2010, and the other just about 2 years ago. So the question is, this is the size of a monumental structure. This is actually Megiddo up in northern Israel. This is dated to the time of Solomon or later, and everybody recognizes that this is a monumental structure to the time after David. So is there any evidence of monumental structures prior to this time? That is the whole quest. And this is actually one of the hottest things in Hebrew scripture archaeology. You may not know about it because if you are a Christian here tonight, we tend to be focused on gospel archaeology. But in the world of biblical archaeology, this is a very, very, very hot topic. Well, it turns out in 2009, here's the old city of Jerusalem. You see, the Golden Dome here is where the temple was. And to the south here, well, this is the wall that surrounds the Temple Mount. The yellow mark there is where the Western Wall is, if you've been to Jerusalem. So just to get yourself oriented. And to the south of the Temple Mount, in this area here, begins the City of David. All right, so that's always had that name, the City of David. And it goes from that yellow circle to the left, kind of towards the corner. That's the original area of Jerusalem. So from this area here, down here would be the original ancient city of Jerusalem at the time of King David, going up the hill to where the temple was eventually going to be built. So this area right here is between where the villagers lived and the temple. And so this would be the place, if there was going to be a royal temple, a royal house, a palace, it would be in this area right here. So fortunately, one of the world's top archaeologists, a woman named Eilat Mazar, who comes from three generations of archaeologists. The Mazar family is like one of the top archaeological families in history. She has undertaken an archaeological excavation in that area. And actually, I did a screenshot of all things of Fox News back then. So archaeologists uncover ancient wall in Jerusalem. This is a picture of Eilat Mazar, and look at the size of those stones. How many shepherds can do that? Now, clearly Eilat Mazar was saying that these are monumental stones dated to the time of David. All right, that's an allegation or an assertion. That's a statement. It has to be verified. The way that archaeology works is somebody digs up something, they make some claims about it, but nothing is official until this event occurs. And what happens is the archaeologist is required to publish a book outlining every possible thing that you can possibly say about this dig. That's called simply publishing. So you might say, oh, I heard that Bob did something in that area. Has he published yet, right? Or they think this has happened yet, but it hasn't been published. Does that make sense? So the act of publishing is the final word, and it takes some time. So here's the problem. Eilat Mazar is a devout Jewish lady. And so she is suspect by the other archaeologists because they say, well, Eilat is simply cooking the books to make David, does that make sense? You know, to make David look. So she is being extremely careful and very, very slow in publishing the results of these deals. But everybody knows that this is a woman who's very serious, she's very scholarly, very professional. If she is hinting that this is dated to the time of David, it's dated to the time of David. She has to go through all those chairs to make sure it's all solid, but this is looks like it's pretty good solid evidence that these are dated from the time of King David. And I went to visit these stones the other day, not the other day, but last year. I have one here. We're going to bring it in. And so I walked all over this place, and it really is quite remarkable. And here she is again pointing at these kind of monumental structures. And the way things are dated is a couple of things. Sometimes you'll find in the cracks between the wall coins. And coins will have maybe the head of an emperor on it. In fact, they will almost always have the head of an emperor on it. And you know when that emperor lived, and so you can say, well, we know that this is around that time of that emperor. The other thing is pottery. Now, pottery was very cheap, and the reason it was cheap is because it breaks easily. So it would break easily, you would just get another one. So they were constantly making and making and making pottery, and so people began to develop styles of pottery. And believe it or not, the pottery styles were very localized to area and year, to region and year. And just to know, just to let you know the exciting life that archaeologists lead, one of the most common PhD degrees that you get is you get a PhD in pottery. Can you imagine your kid telling you, Mom and Dad, guess what? I want to be a potterist. I just made that word up, but it's actually a very common archaeological degree is to get a degree in pottery, because you can imagine how important it is, because that's what dates things. And dating something is everything in archaeology, right? You know, is David a shepherd king or a monumental king? It all has to do with the dating. Most of the controversies have to occur is, when did this occur? Remember the story about the Battle of Jericho, when the walls of Jericho came down? Okay. Well, they dug up the walls of Jericho and found a line of ashes that indicates burning and destruction. But when did that destruction occur? Some archaeologists think that it occurred at the time of Joshua, and some say no. So yes, here's a story, here's evidence of the walls of Jericho collapsing, but when it occurred, everything depends on when. So dating is hugely impactful. So this is Eilat Mazar, and it looks pretty much like these stones when she publishes. I mean, she's already written some articles on it that I've read, that it's going to be dated to the time of David. Now, this is the latest one, though. This is like in 2014 or so, 13. This is, I wanted to go here last year. I made arrangements to go here. This is called Kerbet Kayafa. Kerbet means ruin. Kayafa is the name of the village. This is right near, this is kind of between Jerusalem and the coast, all right? Between Jerusalem and the Mediterranean Sea. I made arrangements to visit this last year, and my plane flight was canceled out of Frankfurt, so I had to spend the night. They put me up in a 5-star hotel in Frankfurt. So I said, well, should I stay here for the rest of the week? Or... No, I left the next day to go to Israel, but I did miss out on visiting this place, so I hope to see it this year. So this is obviously an archaeological ruin. This would be like basically on the border between the kingdom of David and the Philistines. Over here is the gate to get into the city. This is what would they call a 6-chamber gate. So you would walk into the gate this way. This is a reconstruction on the left side. Here you see the remains on the right side. But basically, as you would go in, there would be these chambers that would go off on either side. 6 chambers means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And it was at the gate that all of the administration of the city would occur. So if you needed tax records, a permit, dog license, whatever you need, you would go to the gate, and in one of these places is where you would get that. Just as a quick aside, I didn't get into it too much tonight, but the latest understanding of where the trial of Jesus occurred is they've just discovered, they think, what are archaeological remains of a chambered gate in Jerusalem, and that's where the trial would have occurred, because trials occurred at the gate as well. Does that make sense? I don't have any pictures of that yet. So this is a chambered gate in Kayafa. And this is a reconstruction of what it looked like. Clearly monumental. So the latest archaeological news from the Hebrew scriptures is that there looks to be fairly growing solid news that King David was as he was described in the scriptures as a monumental king. Does that make sense? This is very close to me personally. The Magdala, the excavations at the area of Magdala along the Sea of Galilee in the north of Israel. This is a church, restaurant, and hotel structure that was put up by friends of mine. It's actually put up by a religious order. They're making a religious retreat house with a chapel, restaurant, and retreat house. And the people that run it, the priests that run it, are good friends of mine. So in 2009, as they were building this structure, they found the remains of a first century synagogue. And it was closed off as a closed archaeological site, but every year, because I knew them, we had special permission to go there. Anybody here who's been to the Magdala site with me? Okay, so some of you have been there. Unless you were there last year or the year before, prior to that, it was basically closed to the public, but we had special access to go in, so it was very exciting. Now, why is this important? Well, first of all, it was kind of assumed that there were no synagogues at this time. If you were Jewish and you had something religious to do, you would go to the temple. It was only after the temple was destroyed that the whole idea of meeting in neighborhood synagogues developed. But more and more, they found about 10 or 15 now of these synagogues, and so it looks like the whole synagogue method pre-existed the destruction of the temple. Now, this is important because it's a pristine first century synagogue site. And it was only about 1 foot under the ground. Now, the reason it was never discovered before is that prior to this, it was a seaside park, a seaside beach resort. It was called Hawaii Beach. And the owner was somewhat economical. He decided not to build cabins for his renters, but he built platforms on the ground and then put the cabins on top of these platforms, right? So he never went into the ground. If he had gone into the ground, he would have found this synagogue and been a millionaire. But he didn't. He sold it to these religious order of priests, and now they're raking in the bucks. So that's called a miracle, right? So right now, ironically, as they dug around this area here, they found this site. Fortunately, if you have a house in Israel and you're building a swimming pool, and you dig down, all of a sudden you find something, okay, you have to stop. You have to call in the Israeli Antiquities Authority. They will come in and do an analysis of your property, and they will come up with one of three conclusions. One is, we've examined this archaeological site, and it's not of any consequence. Continue building your swimming pool. That's the best news for you. Second thing is, we have found something important, and we're going to take it and put it in the museum. And then you can continue with your pool. And the third one is, you're not getting a pool. This is too important. And that's what happened here, because this is obviously something that can't be moved. Now, they were the luckiest people in the world, this religious order, Father Juan, because in this entire site, this was the only place that had something of archaeological importance that would stop construction. Now, they found that all of this area here is the ancient city of Magdala, and you can see they're doing archaeological digs under these tents, all this area right here. But once it's archaeologically dug up and published, then they can cover it over and build whatever they want. But they don't need to. These people are going to use this synagogue site and this archaeological site here as an attraction. So It's of interest to Christians. It's of interest to Jews because it's a synagogue site. It's also of interest to Christians because this is about 2 miles from Capernaum. Capernaum is where Jesus lived with Peter and Peter's mother-in-law, right? This is about 2 miles away, and the Gospels clearly say that Jesus always traveled to all of the neighboring synagogues. Father Juan Solana, who runs this joint, is very, very scientifically oriented. He's very careful. He will always say, we cannot prove that Jesus came here. But I think, in all fairness, there is just no doubt that Jesus came, because this is the nearest synagogue to Capernaum, and the Gospels clearly indicate that he went to neighboring synagogues, and it's Magdala, which is where Mary Magdalene came from, one of his number one financial and spiritual supporters. So it's very, very, so here's the people digging. Now, the way an archaeological dig goes, like 9 of these people are probably college students, because you can kind of talk college students into doing this kind of work. Because it's a lark. You know, the archaeological dig season is in the summertime. So they go around to all these schools and say, hey, come to Israel and dig, and it's kind of a lark, right? So they come and they do that. And then maybe one person, maybe this person here, is the actual archaeologist. And so what happens is they're all digging. They give them some rudimentary training. And if they find something, they stop. They come and they get the archaeologist. The archaeologist will come over and say, look at it and say, no, that's nothing. Keep digging. Or congratulations, you found something. So there's like the referee coming over to take a look. So that's the way not all of these people are not archaeologists. Most of them are simply college students that were persuaded to come over. So this is the synagogue site. So a typical synagogue, you'd have a circle of stone chairs, and then an outer circle, and it might have held about 100 people. Now, they found something in the middle, this kind of block of stone. And keep your eye on this column here. So they find this thing here, and they found, you know, a number of these synagogues, but they've never understood what this stone was about. Here's a close-up of it. Now you see this, the pillar, it's on its side. That's where the pillar was found. And then it was later put up. That's very common in archaeological sites. Very often when you first uncover an archaeological site, it's all flattened, right? But one of the ways that you pay for all of that archaeological digging is you invite tourists to come and see ancient Simi Valley. All right? If Simi Valley hundreds of years from now is flat, no one's going to come. So what you're going to do is you're going to take some of the things that are laying on the ground, and you're going to stand them up again so that people have kind of a sense of what Simi Valley looked like at the time. Does that make sense? It's a controversial issue because the whole issue is how much do you reconstruct and how much do you not, right? For instance, in Ephesus, anybody been to Ephesus? Okay. All of that was flat. So all those things that were standing up are reconstructions. But they're beautiful, and that's what gets everyone going there, all right? So this is a common thing that happens in archaeology is you set up a few things. They're probably going to set up more as they go on. So this is a famous archaeologist there. See, this is a mosaic here, and what they do is they pour water on the mosaic, and then that makes it shine more, and you can kind of see it more. But this is a very, very intricate mosaic that was there. It's very, kind of shows that it was a wealthy synagogue. So this is a close-up of the stone. For the long time, this is the only place a stone like this has been found. In all those other synagogues, this is the only place where this kind of stone has been found. They go, what was this for? Did the guy sit on it? The rabbi sit on it? Did they roll a scroll on it? Probably both. But what made it important, and actually the lady archaeologist who published this happened to be there last year when I was there. And she personally gave our group, which was really a lucky deal, she personally gave our group the story of the stone. And you see here, we have columns on either side. We have a menorah in the middle. We have two jars. And on top are round circles. And the analysis is that these are a menorah and manna and columns. Menorah, manna, and columns. What does that tell you? These are the items that you find in the Jerusalem temple, right? And so what this is, basically, is kind of a replica of the things that you find in the temple. And so the idea is that the reason why they didn't think synagogues existed is because if you had something Jewish to do, you would go to the temple. But what happens is people say, well, look, we can't go to the temple all the time. I work during the week, right? I just can't get up and go down to the temple. So a synagogue developed not only as a place to talk and read the scriptures and discuss, but here is a stone that is a replica of the temple. You can't go to the temple, come to Magdala, and you have an archaeological representation of the temple. Does that make sense? This is a very, very brilliant analysis by this woman. So now we have the sifting project. This is very controversial. Is this interesting? Okay, so this is really controversial. Now, here is the Temple Mount. This is really one of my favorite pictures because I don't know if you know, the reason why it's kind of white, that's snow. Jerusalem is at 3,000 feet about, so it actually gets snow in the winter. So here's the Temple Mount. The Golden Dome is where the temple was. Now remember, when the Romans came and they destroyed the temple, they did such a good job, they literally took every little rock and stone apart. It was actually disassembled completely. So much so that there is some disagreement about where the actual temple stood on the Temple Mount. Now, I personally have no doubt whatsoever that the temple stood directly over the spot where that Golden Dome was. I mean, that to me is solid. But there are still some that will disagree here and there. But obviously this is caught up in the Palestinian-Israeli controversy. And part of that Palestinian-Israeli controversy is who has the right to live here. So you can advance many arguments for who has the right to live here. And one of them is often used is history. We were here before you, right? It's kind of a common sense argument. We were here before you, therefore you go, we stay. So the Palestinian approach is to vigorously deny any archaeological evidence that indicates Jewish presence in the Holy Land at all. So any place that is governed or managed by Islamic authorities allows no archaeology. Now, this Temple Mount obviously is within the State of Israel and was appropriated by the Israeli army in the 67 war, after which they immediately returned the operations of it to the Jordanian government. Because at the time, the Israeli government really wasn't that interested in religious issues. So they didn't mind giving it back to the control of the Jordanians. So to this day, the Jordanian government is responsible for the security of that site. Israeli soldiers can patrol it anytime they want, but they allow the Jordanian government to have kind of nominal control in the Palestinian Authority. But the official position of the Palestinian Authority is that there has never been a temple. Can you imagine that? There never was a temple in Jerusalem. That's how politicized science can get. So this area, now this you've got to admit, I mean, this is where the Jewish temple was. This has got to be the richest, richest archaeological site anywhere. I believe the Ark of the Covenant You know, the Ark of the Covenant is the box. Ark means box. The Ark of the Covenant, the box in which was kept the Ten Commandments. You know, the Ark, the Raiders of the Lost Ark. The Ark was in this temple. The temple was actually built to house the Ark. And in the 6th century, the Babylonian Empire came down, conquered the area, and all we have is missing information of the Ark at that time. So the question is, did the Babylonians take the Ark? What I believe is that the Israeli people safeguard the Ark before the Babylonians are coming and put it in hiding someplace. Some people say it's in Egypt. Some people say it's in Ethiopia. And I believe it's underneath that ground. I believe the ancient Israelis would not have removed it from the area, that they would have kept it there, but they hide it underneath there. But there's no archaeology allowed there, because obviously the Palestinians do not want any signs of ancient Israeli occupation or presence on the Holy Land. So a couple of years ago, in this area right here, they wanted to build a new entryway and parking structure, of course. And so they dug it up massively, okay? Now, this is, again, the most richest archaeological area you can imagine. When you do an archaeological site, you know, archaeology is done with toothbrushes, right? Just scrape it off a little bit, scrape it off, because you don't want to disturb things. Because one of the things that's most important about archaeology is dating, right? One of the ways that you date something is that if something is high, it's later than something that's below. So if you're digging down, you're going back in time. Because if I throw something on the ground here outside, eventually it's going to get covered over and get buried, right? So if you dig down to it, it's a way of saying that's older in time. So you can date things by high and low, and also you can determine what something is by what's next to it. In Qumran, in the Dead Sea Scrolls, in the area of the village, they found a large room that they weren't sure what it was. But immediately adjacent to it was a room with shelves of all kinds of pots and bowls and cups. So they figured, okay, this large room must have been the dining room. So very often you'd find out what something is by association. So if you find something, you want to know what's next to it, what's above it, what's below it. If you just dig the whole thing up, you can't tell, right? So what the Muslims did is they dug up this huge, massive area, they took it in dump trucks, and they poured it into the Kidron Valley. Mamma mia. So Gabriel Barkai, one of the very, very wonderful archaeologists, came up with an idea of getting his own dump truck, picking up all that dirt, putting it in buckets, and taking it to this large Quonset hut that you see here, not too far from our hotel. And people would take the dirt, put it in the sifting grate, like a netting, a screen, and pour water on it, and sift through it and find things. So you could find objects, and that's all you could, but you didn't know where it was, what's above it, what's below it, what's on the side and everything. And because this is fairly labor intensive, these are all tourists. And our group does this every year now. We did it last year for the first time. We're going to do it every year. So every year we go, we spend an hour here at the sifting project, and you take a bucket and you kind of go through the dirt. Now, if you find something, you can't keep it. No. It didn't happen. No, you can't keep it, but if it's important, your name gets permanently attached to it. That's kind of cool. So a couple of years ago, the guide, remember I said I go over early to test things out? So a couple of years earlier, the guide and I went over. I said, I want to try out the sifting project to see if our group will do it next year. So we went there, and he was on one grate, and I was on the other, and we were kind of competing, you know. and he found an ancient nail. And what happens is when you find something, you call over the archaeologist, right? He comes over and he looks at it and he goes, yes, this nail is 1,000 years old. I said, really? See this rock? It's 3 million years old. So after about an hour, it gets kind of old, but it is kind of fun to see. And things happen. I mean, this is another scene. So what you do is you pick up one of these buckets, pour it into here. Here's the hose. You hose it down, and then you just sift through it, and you find either pieces of glass, metal, pottery, all these different things, and you put them in different containers. And then you show it to the archaeologist. So this is a recent find. This happened this year. They were finding all kinds of these bits of tile. And after a while, they began to examine the tile and were able to develop these patterns. And this is the brand new archaeological thing. This is literally like about a month old. This is the latest stuff. This is, they believe, is what the floor of the temple looked like. So they're able to, that's really in the weeds of archaeology. I mean, they're able to discover really what the floor of the ancient temple looked like. And this is based on tile from the sifting project. That's really fascinating to me that after 2,000 years, you can actually see what Jesus would have walked on. He would have walked on this floor. And this girl found a 3,000-year-old Egyptian amulet. Yeah, I hate this girl. She's very lucky. No, I mean, she's just obviously very happy. And this happens almost on a weekly basis, and they put this in the papers all the time, you know, and it's exciting, you know. I mean, and to find that she's just very happy. She found a 3,000-year-old Egyptian amulet from from Pharaoh Thutmose. Look at that name, Thutmose. Moses shows that Moses was a common royal Egyptian name. And it's from the time when Egypt, you know, had control of the area. So now we have the Shroud of Turin. I'll talk about this, then we'll take a short break. And I want to end with the bones of St. Peter. Did they actually find the bones of St. Peter in St. Peter's church? You know that story? So we'll talk about that. How many of you saw Barry Schwartz talk on the Shroud? Okay. He is a close friend of mine. He actually stayed with me for 2 days in Whittier, and we just had a wonderful time talking. He is without a doubt the world's top expert on the Shroud. So I'm just gonna, you know, briefly touch on what he really is a major expert on. So the Shroud was basically almost a 14-foot long cloth that was wrapped around the body in this fashion. So if there's any marking on the Shroud, you're going to have the back side of the body on this side of the Shroud and the markings of the front of the body on the top side. So when you peel this back this way, you have the front and back images of a person wrapped in the Shroud. So this is a close-up of the face and a close-up of the hands crossed like this. What's interesting about this picture is that the wounds match the wounds of the gospel. So we have blood coming from the top of the head for the crown of thorns, from the hands, the wrists, not the hands, but the wrists where the nails were placed, and on the back, you see the marks of scourging. So basically, examining the image on the Shroud matches the wounds as exactly described in the gospel account. What's really remarkable, though, is that the image itself is only on the surface of the fibers. If you imagine twine, all right, very frizzy, you know, the image is only on the frizz. It doesn't penetrate into the fibers. So it's on the very, very surface. It doesn't, embed itself deep into the deal. It's just really, really right on the very surface. And some areas, it's darker than others. So that's why you have an image, because you have light and dark. Also, if it's an area where the shroud probably touched the face, it's darker, and then lighter over here, right? Which means that there is some interactivity with the shroud and the body, right? If it was a paint or something, then it would be the same everywhere. But this means that there's something arising from the body where it's directly attached, it's stronger, and where there's some distance between the shroud, it's lighter. So it means the image has some type of interactivity with the shroud itself and the body. So here it is, the image is only on the fibrils. The most remarkable thing of all about the shroud is that when you look at the shroud as it is, it's actually the shroud, when you see it, if you just take the shroud and put it here, it's actually I have this wrong. This is the negative image, and this is the positive image. You see how lights and darks are reversed. You see the face up there. Normally, this is the way the body would look normally. And the other side is actually the negative. So the lights and darks are reversed as you would normally have them. That is just really extraordinary idea that nobody could have thought of prior to the invention of photography, right? So here's the positive and negative. And again, you develop a 3D image again because the image changes based on the distance of the shroud from the body. It's stronger where it touches the body and different from the left. So based on the 3D image data, this is an actual sculpture that there is in Jerusalem, just about a half a mile from our hotel. This is a 3D sculpture of taking the image, the data from the shroud, and developing it into what Jesus would have looked like. This is a fairly accurate, the best view we have based on the shroud of what our Lord looked like. So you can see he was a robust man, right? He was not like what you often find in movies where Jesus is somewhat ethereal and really kind of an advanced hippie kind of person. And the one person who got that right was Mel Gibson in the movie The Passion. And the reason he picked Jim Caviezel to be the person of Jesus is because Jim was a former, he wanted to be an NBA basketball star. He was an athlete. And Mel Gibson wanted an athletic person, a robust leader of people to play our Lord. He was about almost 6 feet high, which would put him just about an inch taller than most people at that time. Just a little bit taller than most people. But again, people at that time lived actually very healthy lives. They actually ate well, and of course they were constantly on their feet because there were very few places to sit down. So you were on your feet, you were up, you were active, you ate fruits and vegetables, very few donuts at that time. We have never found a single ancient donut. So unless you fell, unless you had an accident or a violence, you could live a long time, or a disease, you could live a long time, because they were fairly healthy. So you can see, and the Gospels indicate that he was remember what his occupation was? Okay, that's the English word that is used to translate the Greek word tecton, okay? And tecton actually has a wider term. It's kind of where we get the word technology, too. And it means a general contractor, right? So he was a general contractor in the building trades. There wasn't that much wood at that time. So making a life just as a carpenter wouldn't really work. So basically it would be, what do you need? Plumbing? Got it. Stonemason? Most likely? Got it. And of course, to lift up stones and everything, you'd get pretty strong. So Jesus was a tecton. And most likely, every day, Jesus would get up from his home in Nazareth, and he would walk 4 miles to the neighboring town of Sepphoris. Sepphoris is not mentioned in the Bible, so there's no churches built on the place. You know, one of the problems is if Jesus does something on a certain place, people are so enamored of that that what they want to preserve it, and what they do is they build a church on top of it. You build a church on top of something, you can no longer do any archaeology, right? It kind of freezes it. So the nice thing about Sepphoris is that it's not mentioned in the Bible. There's no churches built there. It's a pristine archaeological site, mainly excavated by a guy named Professor James Strange, who I've met a number of times, and he is the genius of Sepphoris. And it looks like Jesus and Joseph every day would have gotten up, walked about a 45-minute walk, and worked in Sepphoris, because Sepphoris was a Greco-Roman town that was under a massive building project by King Herod. So are there any jobs in Nazareth? No. A lot of jobs in Sepphoris. So every day, Jesus and Joseph would have gone to this wealthy Greco-Roman town where Jesus probably picked up Latin, Greek, and Greek languages. He would have seen Greek theater there. Even though he probably wouldn't have attended, he would have known about the acoustics of Greek theaters. Greek theaters were always built into a hillside. So he would have recognized the power of that acoustic thing. And so later on, when he went to preach to the thousands of people, many people would say, well, that's an exaggeration, because nobody without a microphone can speak to 1,000 people. Except it turns out that where Jesus was speaking, there are a number of natural amphitheaters. And that's where Jesus would have spoken to 4,000 to 5,000 people, a skill that he would have learned by walking to Sepphoris with his father Joseph as a tecton. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So that's the shroud, that's the picture of Jesus, that's quite compelling. They took samples, all kinds of scientific deals. This is the final thing I'll say on this. This is where they cut a piece of the shroud to do carbon dating. If you imagine the shroud is a big rectangle like this, from the extreme lower left corner, they took a 2-inch strip, cut that in half, put that aside, took the half and cut it in 3 strips, gave it to 3 different laboratories and dated it, and it all came back to a medieval date. It's like 1988. No, I mean, in 1988 is when they did the study, when they did the examination. And in 1988, the results came back to dating around 1200, 1300 AD, a medieval date. Shroud is a forgery, it's a fake, all this kind of stuff. Even though to date, there is no scientific understanding of how the image is on the shroud. None. They have no idea how the shroud image is there, but the linen seemed to be dated to Middle Ages. Later on, a number of years later, in about 2005, they re-examined the sample, and the chemist who did the original dating complained to Barry Schwartz, because Barry Schwartz had put on his website an idea that maybe the sample had medieval sewing in it, some medieval thread, which would have skewed the date. And Ray Rogers, the chemist, called up Barry and said, what are you doing putting this bogus stuff on? I have the sample myself. I can prove it that you're wrong. And Barry said, great, I'm not going anywhere, I'll wait. And Barry left, I mean, the Ray Rogers left and came back about an hour later and said, I was wrong. There is other thread in there. So they examined it, because they have the original samples. And there is what's called French interweaving, which was done by, when you had a relic like this and you're constantly holding it up, bringing it down, holding it up, bringing it down, it weakens the edge. So what they did is they re-sewed around the edges to make it stronger and did it in a way that was very difficult to see so it would blend in. So the edges have medieval thread in it, and that skewed the date. So here's the, see, we have the thick and the thin yarn. So medieval cotton interweaving. So the results to date, the combined evidence from chemical kinetics, analytical chemistry, cotton content, and mass spectrometry proves that the material from the radiocarbon area of the shroud is significantly different from the rest of the main cloth. So the dating was accurate, but it wasn't the date, but it wasn't a dating of the cloth of the shroud itself, but the edge. The radiocarbon sample thus was not part of the original cloth and is invalid for determining the age of the shroud. So the next part is just a little technical. I'll just go through those. I'm not even going to go through them, but these are just different items that are kind of the conclusions. Not a scorch, not a medieval camera, no iron oxide rubbings, image within 48 hours of death. But the basic thing is there is no, to date, there is no understanding of the image itself. People say it's radioactive, it's electric, and all that, fine. But there's no scientific verification of any of it. It's just simply nobody knows. Does that make sense? So excavating Jesus, the next thing we'll talk about is the discovery of Peter's tomb, but we've been sitting for a while, so just take a little short break. We'll come back after just 2 minutes and talk about the bones of St. Peter. All right, welcome back. So this is discovery of St. Peter's tomb takes place over a number of decades. It first begins in 1939 when Pope Pius XI died, and he asked if he could be buried as close as possible to the tomb of St. Peter. Now, St. Peter's Basilica in Rome is called St. Peter's because the tradition is that St. Peter was buried there, and they built this church on top of his tomb. The story is that Peter was, the red oval there, at the time of Nero, was a kind of a coliseum, an arena, but in an oval shape. And it was the circus of Nero. And it was basically a place for throwing the Christians to the lions and crucifying Christians and things like that. So Peter was crucified there. And in the middle of the circus was an Egyptian obelisk, right? And again, that was one of the ways that Romans showed their domination. When they conquered Egypt, they took some of their stuff, like the obelisk, you know, the big pylon, and brought it to Rome as a way of saying, you know, look what we did, right? So this obelisk is in the middle of Nero's circus, and basically next to that obelisk, Peter was crucified upside down, the tradition is, and then he was executed, and right next to the circus was a Roman cemetery. So here you see the red line shows the Roman arena, Nero's arena, and the purple mark there is a portion of the cemetery that was right next to the circus. The Romans did not bury their people underground. As we talked about with Jesus' tomb, they would either cut a cave out of rock or they would build a house, a mausoleum above ground. But it was in the same way they would put the body in an ossuary box and put it in that house. And all the houses would be together. And so literally, you would have the Smith family mausoleum, the Robinson family's mausoleum, the Williams family, you know, down on either side. So it looked like a little village. And the Greek word for city is polis. The Greek word for dead is necro. So it was a necropolis, a necropolis, right? And this is a picture of a typical Roman necropolis. These are actually family mausoleums. So here is the Basilica of St. Peter's now. So you can see how massive it is here. And here is the baldacchino, or the big structure over the main altar here. Only the Pope is allowed to say Mass there. And this is St. Peter's. And then here's the base of it. Then there's another floor, and then underneath that is the ruins of a Roman necropolis. There's the base floor of St. Peter's. There's the floor below it. And then below that is this Roman necropolis. Now, that the picture of the actual, this is a schematic of the layout, Necropolis Street. So you would you would walk along this street here like this. And then off it, on either side, would be all these different Roman mausoleums. This is the actual street below St. Peter's Basilica. This is a tour that you can take, and it is the hottest ticket in Rome. They only allow 100 people per day to go through because it's all temperature controlled, humidity controlled, so they can't have too many human bodies in there to preserve the artwork. And so it is the hottest. I was lucky when they first opened it in the early 90s, you could just walk in. So I've been there several times. But now you have to reserve time in advance, tickets and all that kind of stuff. So it is the most popular thing to do in Rome is what they call the scavi tour, which means Roman, that's the Roman word for excavations. So this is underneath, this is directly underneath the floor of St. Peter's. So the story is that Peter was taken down from the cross because he was upside down. One of the quickest ways to do that is they just cut the feet off and his body comes down. And they would just basically throw him over into the Roman cemetery. The Roman Christians would gather him and they placed him, eventually his bones in an ossuary, and then against the cemetery wall, they built this shrine. And here's two columns, a flat tabletop, and a shrine. This column is actually about 5 feet high. So that's called a little monument to St. Peter. And that's actually a artist rendering, a kind of a 3D model of it. And then basically underneath it, they would dig a hole and put the bone box of Peter's bones in that box right down there. And then this is what's called the red wall, of all things. And it's the backdrop there. There's another view of it. So this is what, from different writings and artist renderings, archaeologists for centuries have known, this is ostensibly what is underneath St. Peter's, but nobody knew for sure. Until Pius XI died, he wanted to be buried there, and as they started digging, they found elements, they found the Necropolis Street. Now this is during the Second World War. Remember, Rome is now cut off from the rest of the world. It's an ally, I mean, the Italian government is an ally of the Nazis. So there were very, very few tourists, you know, and so Pope Pius XII felt this is a good time to really do a formal archaeological excavation to find out really what is going on there. Is it actually the tomb of St. Peter? So during the day, life would go on normally, but all night, guys would be down there with lights digging, right? And they basically uncovered that entire Necropolis Street. And they and then they eventually uncovered this. It was very, very exciting for them. Just, you know, they, okay, all of a sudden they would say, oh my God, there's the column, there's the other column, there's this, there's that. That must mean right underneath is the burial box. So they dug under there and son of a gun, they found a burial box. And they opened it up and it was wrapped, there were bones wrapped in purple. Purple is a royal color, color of devotion. Done. So they examine the bones, and to their dismay, they find that it was the bones of about 5 people and a couple of animals. Okay. So, but what can we say? It is absolutely the tomb of St. Peter. We did not find St. Peter. But everybody understood, because it matched entirely, by centimeter, the archaeological prediction of what would be there. They found it. They could say, yes, we have absolutely, without doubt, found St. Peter's tomb. But in the course of 2,000 years, grave robbers, tomb robbers, etc., the bones are gone. So It was like 1942, 43, something like that. Then in 1960, a lady named Margaret Warducci, who was an archaeologist at the University of Rome, I should say that this spot here where you see the red square, at a later date from the time of Peter, this red wall behind was beginning to weaken, so they built a wall coming out 90 degrees from the red wall. See that? 90 degrees to strengthen it, to support it, like a buttress wall. On that wall was a lot of graffiti. Graffiti is a very, very big thing in the world of archaeology. Graffiti is a very, very bad thing in the world of a city today. But in the world of archaeology, it means somebody came to that spot and said, Jesus, pray for me. Now, why would they come there? Because they felt that that was the spot where Jesus did something. So graffiti marks are a very, very powerful archaeological sign that from an early age, people said something important happened here. This wall that came out was called the graffiti wall, the red wall and the graffiti wall, because there was just a huge amount of graffiti on it. So here's a artist rendering of that buttress wall coming out. You see that? So there's the graffiti wall. And let me just show you where this is in relation to St. Peter. So here's the large papal altar here. And you can walk down here underneath it to be in that area. And that's what you would see. And so that's generally where that graffiti wall would be underneath the altar of St. Peter. Do you see that? Okay, now in examining that wall a little closer, again, here's the graffiti wall. On this side here, I'm sorry, it's on this side here, this Margaret Guarducci analyzed the graffiti wall and found, see, this is not the graffiti that was there, but this is an example of what it would look like, and found this stone with the phrase Petros Ani, which is Greek for Peter within. So they cut into the wall and found these boxes of bones. The bones of one man, 64, 65 years old, and no feet bones. Isn't that amazing? So this is directly underneath the altar of St. Peter. The altar of St. Peter. Only the Pope can walk up there. Now, you know, in our Catholic faith, Francis is not the successor of Benedict. And Benedict is not the successor of John Paul II. Each pope is the successor to Peter, right? So there's Peter and the next pope, and then Peter and the next pope, and then Peter, next pope. Do you see that? So each pope, Pope Francis did not succeed Benedict. He is the successor to St. Peter. But a very beautiful thing that happened under John Paul II is that he built he dug a hole in the floor of St. Peter's, put this grate over it so you can walk on it, but this is holes in it, and you can look down here. Just before you walk up to the altar of St. Peter, you can look down that grate and you can see the bones of St. Peter in that I showed you there. So just before every pope walks up to the altar to say Mass, he can actually look down and see the bones of the pope who he succeeded, St. Peter. And of course, there's a picture of the grate. And so from that place to the whole rest of the world, what the Romans thought they could stop, didn't. So the Romans thought you never interfere with Rome. What they should have understood is you never interfere with God.
That's right.
So thank you.